This is Sports Talk with Phil Kornblut and Chris Bergen. Sports Talk is heard across the state on radio affiliates of the Sports Talk Media Network and is streaming live on SportsTalkSC.com, as well as Twitter, Facebook, and YouTube. The South Carolina Education Lottery lucky number to call in is 888-898-2525. That's 888-898-2525. Now, here are Phil and Chris with tonight's edition of Sports Talk.
All right, welcome in, everybody. Sports Talk Friday edition. Big Friday night here on Sports Talk across the state. Sports Talk Media Network, great to have you with us. Phil Kornblut and Josh Cohen at our Columbia studios. And Chris Bergen from the Berge Palace in Sardis. All right, South Carolina hit the practice field bright and early this morning, about 9:23, give or take a few minutes here or there for stretching and light warm-ups. We got a chance to watch three segments of practice, and I came away knowing absolutely nothing about what I had just seen, typical of a football practice the first day of practice. Guys were running around in helmets and shorts. I mean, they were doing their thing, and they were the parts that we got to see, mostly stretching and special teams and lineman drills. I mean, they look good. They look like an SEC football team. I think South Carolina has the potential of surprising some people this season. The potential. Of course, you know what potential is. I mean, you got to take the potential and turn it into the real deal. And we'll see if they're good enough to do that against a difficult schedule. But I think with this roster they have compiled, and now the quarterback play, that's a question mark. I mean, I know people love Lenore Sellers, and they think highly of what his future might be, but he hasn't proven a darn thing yet. And Robbie Ashford, who we'll hear from tonight. I wanted to run this Robbie Ashford interview tonight, Chris, because he's so good. He's such a good talker. And, I mean, he told us things yesterday that I don't think he had revealed when he told us about the shots he was having to take prior to Auburn games last year. And that's why he couldn't throw the ball well. He was playing with a dinged-up shoulder. He says now he's fine. Come watch him throw. So thought we'd hear from him tonight. Meantime, Clemson on the practice field for day two. Today we'll hear from the Tigers offensive lineman Marcus Tate. In fact, the Tigers with pretty much a veteran group returning. Lee.
Four or five starters.
And Tate and Parks and Miller. They should be. If they correctly solve their center position, Chris, they should be very good up front if these guys play well.
And Lithicum appears to be the guy, at least going into camp, that's going to take that spot at center. But you're right, Phil. And you listen to Marcus Tate in particular, and I put him up because, much like you said, Robbie Ashford, Marcus Tate's a very good talker. Self-admittedly, he said he doesn't like to talk, but you listen to him, he's very insightful, talked a lot about how the offensive line and the entire team, very hungry off of the, not just this past year. What I thought was interesting, he's looking back 2 and 3 years ago where they, you know, lost 2 games, lost 3 games, lost 4 games. He said, you know, we just can't show up and go and expect good things to happen because we're Clemson. We've got to go make things happen. He says this is as hungry a team as he's been around at Clemson. So the offensive line, with the amount of experience they've got returning, they feel pretty good about that set group up front. And like you said, if the center position falls into place, they might be awfully good, that starting offensive line.
Yeah, and going back to the quarterback thing, I mean, we justifiably question Cade Klubnik at Clemson and wonder how good he will be this year. And I think that's justifiable, but at least you have a body of work to break down with him going back 2 seasons. You know, he filled in for Uyangale and then eventually took the job at the ACC championship game. Then he had it all last year. You've got a body of work to dissect. When it comes to Lenore Sellers, I mean, it's all about potential and promise. We've seen the flashes in the few games he played in last season and in the spring game. We know he's big. We know he's athletic. We know he's smart. We know he makes good decisions, at least he did in high school and from what we've seen so far in college. But until the Gamecocks, until it's proven that they have a big-time, successful, winning quarterback, you do still have to wonder about how good this season can be for them.
Absolutely. That's a question for any team that does not have an experienced quarterback returning. And I think, you know, we sort of get caught looking at the forest inside the trees because we know how good Lenore Sellers was in high school. I think if you ask people outside the state of South Carolina, they've got no clue what this kid did at South Florence and how talented he was in the limited amount of snaps he got last year. And what he attempt four passes, I think, a couple of touchdowns.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, no question he's got skills. He's very, very intelligent young man, very sharp. You know, you can throw pretty much every play in the playbook at him and he'll absorb it. But that's why I asked you the question a couple of days ago. Do you think Robbie Ashford has a legitimate shot? And now knowing what you said he told you guys yesterday about really not being able to throw because his shoulder was so messed up, if that's corrected, I mean, could we potentially see Robbie Ashford play maybe more in the Old Dominion game than we first thought that might be the case?
I think you might. I think there's going to be a place for Robbie Ashford in this offense on a regular basis. And, I mean, He's played in 22 SEC games. He started about half of them. So that's got to be something in his favor. He's played in the toughest venues in the SEC. He's faced Alabama at home and in Tuscaloosa. So, and he's a tremendous athlete. You know, he went out to Oregon and he redshirted his first year. He played baseball at Oregon. He played 20 games of baseball in his second year. So football-wise, he's only played two seasons, the 2 years at Auburn. So, I mean, I really think Shane Beamer says he's a man of his word. There's still a competition going on at the quarterback spot, and this fall camp and the two scrimmages they have will determine who that starting quarterback's going to be and who's going to get most of the shots, most of the snaps there with the first team offense. So we've got that coming your way tonight. Mike Morgan tonight at 6:30. Morgan on the move. Looking forward to his thoughts on preseason football. And 7:35. We'll go play a little golf with George Bryan III. Birdies, bogeys, and biceps around the state of South Carolina, keeping an eye on the 93rd South Carolina Golf Association Amateur Championship for Zach Adams of Charleston. Back-to-back 64s. What I wouldn't do to shoot back-to-back 64s. Not back-to-back like front nine, back nine. I'm talking about two different rounds. You didn't catch my joke there, did you?
Yeah, not in the cards.
You didn't catch.
See, I did.
But it went right over your head. You didn't catch.
Because I've shot 64 on the front nine, and you know, there were times I was not happy about it, and times when you first get started, hey, that's not so bad. But, yeah.
No, 64 in nine is bad all the time.
Yeah.
There's
well,
no.
If you're, you know, eight years old, it's not.
Chase Klein, 66-65. He's 11 under. He's three back. And then Todd White, the venerable one. Gosh, he's been around forever. He shot 70 yesterday, came back with a 63 today. So he's at 9 under. He's from Spartanburg. And Matthew Doyle from Somerville, 67-66. He's 9 under. Some golfers are still on the course at the Country Club of Charleston. So we'll update all of this with George. We'll talk about the Summer Olympic Golf Championship as well. When George joins us, 7:35. Now, South Carolina got a very nice commitment today in football. Somebody that appeared to be ready to commit to the Gamecocks months ago finally went public today with it. Shane Beamer put out one of his posts on X. It looked like he might have broken his keyboard because he just put out a woo scream on social media when Kendall Daniels, safety from Norfolk, Virginia, announced his commitment to the Gamecocks about 1:30 or so. So they were very excited, apparently, to get him. I rate him. So I've gone to my rating system, and it's a very simple rating system, Chris and Josh.
It's the corn stalks?
It's the, it's the corn stalk and it's the corn cob. So The corn stalk is like, If you get a corn stalk, that means you're kind of a promising prospect, but you still maybe have some ways to go. You weren't as heavily recruited, but you were recruited enough. If you're the corn cob, you're the complete thing. You're done. You've been grown, and you've been shucked, and you've been eaten.
I like
it. So if you get the corn cob, then that means you're high level. That's the highest level you can get. He gets a corn cob.
So this kid's a corn cob?
He's a corn cob. He gets a corn cob because his offer list was impressive, and South Carolina won a very good recruiting battle for him. So more on that in recruiting coming up tonight. That's the big recruiting news of the day thus far. Still no word on Dylan Alfred, a Clemson target, the wide receiver from Sarah Land, Alabama. Clemson and Ole Miss who's supposed to announce today, but and indications continue to point towards Ole Miss, but I have not seen any announcement from him just yet, so keeping a watch out for that. And last night we had the championship game of the South Carolina American Legion, a baseball tournament in Florence, and it's Camden Post 17 coming away with the championship. Boy, that's a terrific American Legion program, Post 17 in Camden. They won a lot of championships. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
The P-17s, they call them, right?
Yep, correct.
And 9-2 over Florence Post 1. And so they advance to the next phase. I guess it's a regional competition. Not sure where. Usually in North Carolina.
Yeah, I think North Carolina and Virginia may host. It's a Southeast Regional, and you're right. It's in Asheboro.
Yeah. North Carolina.
Correct. Yeah. Sorry. Yes, okay. Asheville. And then, of course, the American Legion World Series are held in Shelby, North Carolina.
Mm-hmm. That's good. That's good. Well, congrats to those guys, and good luck moving forward. We'll be keeping a watch out on you. Phone number, 888-898-2525, South Carolina Education Lottery. Lucky number to reach us here on Sports Talk. If you'd like to grab a line and join us for a few minutes, we can do that. You know,
did you see the Kentucky story today?
I did, yeah. I mean, it's like we don't care that you did this anymore, do we? I didn't think we cared about what you did in the past and, you know, any violations of NCAA rules that today are totally against the law to enforce those rules according to the court system. Try to enforce those rules now and, you know, you're going to lose a lawsuit, NCAA. But I guess they can go back and apply their penalties once again, right?
Evidently, vacating wins is the only avenue that they have, the only quiver they've got left, you know, arrow in their quiver that they have left. I thought Mike Morgan made a great point about this. We'll ask him coming up shortly. But he tweeted out, in case you missed it, the NCAA has placed Kentucky on probation and vacated wins after at least 11 players received payment for jobs they did not perform. This seems to happen a lot in college athletics over the years. But anyhow, Mike said another silly NCAA penalty. So what if a year later we found out, perish the thought, one of the vacated wins was against another team forced to vacate wins?
Hmm.
Do we call that a tie? So yeah. I did have somebody ask me the question, you know, let's assume one of those wins, I'm thinking they beat South Carolina back in 2021.
Mm-hmm, they did.
The Gamecocks don't get a win. They don't get to reverse that loss.
No.
It just stays a loss in there on their side,
mm-hmm.
And now it becomes a vacated win for Kentucky, correct?
That's correct. Which is the way it should be. I mean, you shouldn't gain a W because of what, you know, some other team did, breaking the rules. You still lost the game on the field.
Right.
16 exactly. to 10. 16 to 10 was that game. It was Shane Beamer's first season as the Gamecocks coach. September 25th, they played that game against Kentucky and lost it 16 to 10. And, yeah, this involved at least 11 football players receiving payment for work not performed from spring of 21 through March of 22. This involved hospital jobs, according to the Lexington Herald Leader. I mean, like, were they playing doctor?
Gosh, I hope not.
Were they playing doctor and nurse? I mean, good gracious. But whatever they – first of all, shame on them, shame on Kentucky, but shame on the hospital. What'd you have folks in there?
Yeah.
What kind of jobs were they doing and you weren't paying them, you know? I mean, people – nobody should be employed in a hospital setting who's not a serious health giver. You know, somebody taking health giver, health – what's the
– health provider.
Health provider. I mean, seriously. You know, some clown walking around in his football jersey, you know, sticking his head in your room – wondering if you should pull the plug.
My guess is you could be janitorial services, washing floors and changing bed sheets and that type thing. I mean, that would be stuff you could do. But when you just show up and then you clock in and then head right back home, it doesn't really matter what they wanted you to do, does it? I mean, you could have been scheduled for surgery, but you weren't going to perform it, thank goodness.
Huh. You would hope not. Not in this case. So anyway, that's the story there on Kentucky. It really doesn't involve, I mean, South Carolina, except for the fact that the Gamecocks played them. And I want to do this real quick. You know, one thing about this show, it's always been one thing. What's it always been besides entertaining, enlightening, and exciting? It's always been fair, right? I think we always try to be fair. So I think to be fair, I want to bring up this story by Michael DeCourcy, the outstanding writer for the Sporting News about the female boxer from Algeria. Because we, like a lot of people around the world, pretty hard on her for what happened in that bout the other day with the young lady from Italy, who today apologized for her comments about what she said the other day. And I bring this up because DeCourcy is a highly respected journalist, and he did some research on this individual, shed some light on it that I didn't realize myself. So he wrote that the boxer, Imane Khalif, welterweight quarterfinals of the 24 Olympics, will fight Saturday against a woman from Hungary. And talking about the fight the other day, 46 seconds. And he writes, Khalif has been battling for more than a year through merely to climb in the Olympics ring, and it appears that was the least of what she will face for as long as she remains an active athlete. Of course, she was criticized by thousands of people, millions of people, perhaps. So he writes the following. It is illegal for a person to be transgender in Algeria, where Khalif grew up in a small rural village. Pretty much every letter in the LGBTQ descriptor can lead to a person spending up to 3 years in prison in that country. This is a religiously strict nation that is vigorously defending Khalif, not some Northern California liberal conclave, is how he put it. The Algeria Olympic Committee released a statement calling out the lies and baseless propaganda that fueled what they wrote as the unethical targeting and maligning of our esteemed athlete. Her passport lists her as a female. DeCourcy writes, by every account, she was raised as a girl. By her account, when she wanted to play her country's most popular sport, soccer, she was discouraged by the boys in her village. When she decided to take up boxing, she had to evade the disapproval of her father, who did not see it as a sport fit for girls. He continues to write, Khalif had passed any and all tests relative to her gender from the time she began competing internationally a half dozen years ago until she reached the 2023 World Championships. He writes that she's not some kind of great boxer. 51 times she's fought. She's lost 9 times. Finished 17th in the 18 World Championships, 33rd a year later. In the 21 Olympics, she lost in the quarterfinals. In her most recent world competition, the 22 World Championships, she lost a unanimous decision in the light welterweight class. When she returned to fight in that same event a year ago, she advanced to the gold medal bout, but then was disqualified by the International Boxing Association. The IOC, he writes, is not trusting the IBA to run the competition in Paris, nor in Los Angeles 4 years from now, with the IOC indicating in a statement issued Thursday, it wants the boxing federations of competing nations to found a new governing body. Eliminating boxing from the Olympic program is a possibility if that does not develop, DeCourcy wrote, which would be huge. I mean, boxing has been such a mainstay in Olympic competition since, as long as I can remember. So,
and if you take it out, Phil, where, I mean, let's face it, in the United States, where boxing back in the 70s and 80s was such a big, big deal in early 90s, but now it's fallen off the face of the earth, where would these athletes on the men's side as well?
Mm-hmm.
If you're going to eliminate women's boxing, I mean, where would be their goal? What would be their plateau? Or do they get out and turn to MMA or an entirely different sport altogether?
Yeah, exactly. Well, that'd be something. So all I'm saying here is that to believe that this individual was a man would be incorrect.
Correct.
She never was a man. She's been a female since birth, according to reports and the facts. And now, I mean, does she have a body, an internal body makeup? You know, that might be different from a typical female. That's possible. I mean, she certainly looks very physical, but she is what she is. And so, you know, if I said anything last night, which I can't remember if I absolutely said it or not, but if I did, then I apologize for suggesting that she was trans or was a man. She's fully, from what I can tell, you know, she's fully a woman and should be allowed to box in these events.
It's funny. He actually tagged a story about her playing soccer or trying to play soccer. And because she was unable to play soccer, it's the reason she got into boxing. The story says the boys in her village felt threatened and picked fights with her. And ironically, it was her ability to dodge the boys' punches that actually got her into boxing.
Yeah. Well, let me say this,
too. She's dealt with this for a long, long time.
You know, I remind people that they talk about her knocking the opponent out in 46 seconds the other day, and the opponent, you know, talking about how it hurt. Well, it is boxing. It's going to hurt. Mm-hmm. I remind everybody what Mike Tyson did to Michael Spinks, okay? Knocked him out in 30 seconds.
Yeah, most of Tyson's fights were over before the first round.
Well, and he thought things were hurting. Michael Spinks thought things were hurting after he took a couple of shots from Tyson. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, that's boxing. You can go down, you know, couple of shots to the right place, and boom, it's over. So, anyway, I wanted to bring that up because we did talk about it last night, and to be fair, we need to share the other side of the information that's now come out. You know, you go by the information at your disposal when something happens, and the initial reaction was everywhere that this was, and I think because of the way the boxer from Italy reacted, dropping to her knees and crying and refusing to shake hands and all of that, saying it's unfair, and knowing that there are, I mean, let's be real now, knowing that there are true cases where you've got former men, now women, who are beating women in sports and beating them severely in the pool, and in other, you know, other sports as well, I guess primarily in the pool is where we've heard a lot about that. So it's right to call that out when it's happened, and I think it's also right to correct it when it needs to be corrected. As I see this, I mean, I think we needed to correct this, because if you thought otherwise yesterday, it's not the case.
Well, and there's so much misinformation that got fueled by this. I mean, even the current Republican nominee for president, Donald Trump, who's been in that office before, he's already said, he basically said, I will keep men out of women's sports. Well, and he used that as a platform, but it's an incorrect platform for her in particular. Now, you've got plenty of other options if you want to go that route, but that's probably not the one you want to, you know, stake your campaign pledges on.
Well, I think we can all agree on that. I think we can all agree on men don't need to be playing in women's sports. That's not good for women. It's not good for, you know, people who support women's sports. You know, Title IX, you're taking away opportunities from women to compete in their sports. Not just compete, but win. Because, I mean, Mother Nature is the way it is, and it's she made men for the most part physically superior to women. There are exceptions, but I think by and large that's the way it works, and in the sports world in particular. So Just want to get that corrected, or not necessarily corrected, but be kind of fair about how we address that story. Be right back. Okay, we're back on Sports Talk. Sports Talk Media Network, Friday night. Phil Kornblut, Chris Bergen, and Josh Cohen, Mike Morgan to join us here in just a moment. Want to remind you, as the summer rolls on, it's still hot out there, folks. Great place to cool off. The Grand Strand of South Carolina, great person to put you in the coolness of the Atlantic Ocean in Myrtle Beach and Surfside and Garden City and Litchfield and Pawleys as you come up the coast, all those areas. That's Jimmy Smith at James Smith Real Estate, 843-237-4246, online at pawleysvacationrentals.com. Whether you need a place to hang out for a weekend, a place to hide for a week, a place to get away to for a month or more, let Jimmy handle all of that for you, put you in the right spot at the right price. 843-237-4246, PaulysVacationRentals.com for your perfect beach getaway. All right, time to visit with Mike Morgan. Another edition of Morgan on the Move here on Sports Talk, brought to you by Columbia Discount Appliances. Same appliances, same brands, but for less. They have delivery available throughout South Carolina, so give Sherry a call right now at 803-770-3008. It's 803-770-3008 for new appliances delivered to your door today.
Sponsored by Love Chevrolet. Incredible summer savings all summer long on the entire lineup of award-winning Chevys. I-26 at Harbison and at lovechevy.com. Together, let's drive.
All right, Mike Morgan joining us here on Sports Talk. Morgan on the Move, last night away from his regular spot. Joining us tonight here on Sports Talk. Where you been off to?
Oh, boy. Well, since we last spoke, let's see. I think I told you about the trip to Yellowstone, which included Montana, Idaho, and Wyoming. Then it was Kentucky, which is where my wife is from. Then it was some time in South Florida, kind of, as I like to call it, Studio South. And now it's back in Atlanta.
And when did you see the DeLorean?
Yeah, that was – the DeLorean was in Kentucky in front of a sushi restaurant. Some guy actually had an authentic, like, this was not some replica. This was an actual DeLorean. I don't know how many of those are still in circulation, but somebody had one. Phil, that would be perfect for you.
I think that would fit my personality perfectly, yeah.
Get him a flux capacitor.
I totally agree with that. Flux capacitor, yeah. Of course, the guy that invented the car, it didn't wind up too good for him, wound up getting busted on a cocaine deal, but you know, we all have a journey.
Yes, we do. And your journey continues, and your journey continues into football season. You ESPN guys, have you gotten your schedules yet? Do you know what it's going to look like for you this coming season?
I do not. Nor do I know the NFL schedule that I'll be taking part in as well for Compass National Radio. So it's basically a week-to-week basis, and hopefully we'll know more late August, and then we'll just kind of play it by ear then. And, you know, before you know it, you're like in week seven, and then it's college basketball. And then it just keeps – I always say, well, once you get to August, it's like the days are shorter, the speed of the months, it's like warp speed. Mm. I don't know what happens, but for some reason – we just put it into an extra gear, and that's the time of year I kind of wish we could slow it down a little bit, but they don't ask me.
Well, and you also age faster when that happens, too. Keep that in mind.
Okay, fair enough. Fair enough. Yeah. I will take it from you, being the patriarch of sports talk.
Faster the months go by, the quicker death is upon us.
Wow. What a bummer that is to lead into this segment.
I didn't mean to depress you or anything. So we're underway with camps all over the SEC, ACC, all over the country. And, I mean, maybe finally here for a little while we can put all the talk of lawsuits and expansions and NIL deals and all that kind of stuff maybe behind us a little bit and play a little football and separate the men from the boys out there.
Yeah, I think, look, it's good for guys like us who do shows, and I'll throw in another little plug for JC and Morgan, which is kind of a national college football podcast. That gives us stuff to talk about. It's red meat. But honestly, I think we're all a little bit fatigued from all of these storylines that involve nothing on the field. And for many people, these storylines kind of have negative connotations. I mean, I still think, and I know I could just hear it in your voice whenever you talk about something like the portal or NIL, you kind of hearken back to, why can't we just keep it the way it was, or conference migration, or expanded playoffs. These are not things that everybody is in favor of. For me, it's an a la carte. I mean, I like the expanded playoff. I like facets of NIL. I think the portal is out of control, and the way we're doing things right now in college football it's a mess. And any coach will tell you that, at least off the record they will. So I think the games can't get here soon enough, because all of those things that kind of leave a bad taste in your average fan's mouth, you're not thinking about it once you've got games to focus on. So I can't wait for that.
The fans, I see no real drop-off in enthusiasm, interest. They're not turned off by the prices. Now, what I will be interested to see is what happens with this expanded playoff, and we have home playoff games, and they slap the ticket prices on those tickets. They put the prices on those tickets. What do you expect? Have you heard anything? What do you expect? First of all, who sets the prices for the playoffs? And number two, have you heard anything about what those ticket prices will look like when the playoffs roll around in December?
You know, I haven't really thought about that because, for example, if a South Carolina or Clemson hosts a regional, I'm pretty sure the NCAA sets the prices on those. They're at least in the, you know, it used to be it's set a bid, and basically you're bidding that the money going to the NCAA, and then you try to make up for it in tickets. There's some type of financial setup there, but my point is that the NCAA is involved in that, and they're getting some of those funds. I don't know for home playoff games how that's going to work.
Mm-hmm.
That's an interesting question that I really don't have an answer for, because as we know, college football is – they're running their own deal. I mean, they're not beholden to the NCAA. For example, the March Madness contract, which is about $1 billion a year, that goes to Indianapolis. Now, of course, they've got to dole shares out to the teams and conferences that make it, but they still control the purse strings. That's not the way it is in college football. I don't want to say they're completely powerless, but they kind of are when it comes to the financial setup of the college football postseason. So I don't know how that'll work. I know one thing, it'll be expensive. Whatever it is, it's going to be pricey, and some fans will be priced out, unfortunately. That's just kind of the nature of the beast.
Yeah, I mean, that was my question. How are fans going to react? Will there be sticker shock? And also remember, students aren't going to get their free tickets or their reduced price tickets or whatever, however it's done for them during the school year. I mean, it's every seat will be up for sale to the general public. And I mean, I they envision, certainly take for example, let's just use the locals. If Clemson or South Carolina makes the playoffs, I'm sure they're envisioning 80,000 fans at Clemson, you know, buying those tickets. How many tickets will the visiting team get to sell? You know, South Carolina, 77,000. Will we see sellouts? I mean, what if What if there aren't sellouts in these playoff games because of the price, you're tired already? I mean, think about this. You're a fan of a team that makes the playoff. You've gone through a 12-game regular season. You've played your rival in an emotional game up and down. You possibly have played in your conference championship game. And now, you know, you're jumping into the playoffs. If you lose your championship game, you could still make the playoffs and have to play one of those first round games.
Correct. I don't know if you'd be hosting then, but to go back to your equation, I mean, look, we're talking about fans. We're not playing the games. So, I mean, if the most taxing thing a fan has to do is show up to the stadium for an eighth time in a given year, as opposed to seven, yeah, I think they'll do it. Yeah. I don't think there's going to be a concern about attendance for playoff. This is not like a tier three bowl game with, you know, 80% of the seats empty. This is a playoff game. And in the case of South Carolina Clemson, since you use those two as an example, I don't think there's any question those stadiums would be sold out. Mm-hmm. I think there'd be a demand for tickets that will not be met.
Even if the ticket price is let's just say $125.
Well, look, first off, there's bean counters that have to figure out what the sweet spot is. I mean, they do that for a living. People that every university has somebody in charge of that, right?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
They determine, okay, what's the price? What's going to be too high that's going to break people, but what's high enough where we make the most money? I mean, that's how people like, for example, a Chris Massaro, that's how he eventually became an athletic director of Middle Tennessee State, because that's what he did at South Carolina. You know, you've got people that are – that's their job to sit there and crunch all those numbers. So I'm pretty confident they'll come up with the right number, and I'm certainly confident – I mean, let's just say, for example, it's Carolina. If Carolina makes a college football playoff, which would set up the biggest game in the history of the 100-plus years of playing football at Williams-Brice Stadium, I don't care what you're charging, there's not going to be an empty seat. There's not going to be an empty seat there. Mm-hmm. And for Clemson fans, you know, I know it was, what, six straight playoffs when Dabo really had it going. If they get back, something tells me the same people that are paying for a slide in the middle of a football complex, they'll find enough money between the seat cushions to get to Death Valley.
Mike Morgan on the move here with us on a Friday night on Sports Talk. And Mike, speaking of sort of the unintended consequence of expansion in the playoffs, Dabo mentioned it yesterday. His players talked about it. They're already thinking about playing additional games, i.e. the home playoff game, the semifinals, the championship game, whatever the case may be. It looks like they're tweaking their preseason practice to accommodate for the fact that they may play well into January. Do you anticipate us getting to a situation where players aren't ready to go week one, or there is a situation where you look at your schedule and perhaps – you sit some players, you know, rest them mid-season so that potentially if you've got, let's take, Ohio State, Michigan, Alabama, Georgia, those type teams that are probably going to get into the playoffs, a game that they feel like they could win, maybe some of those starters don't play?
I mean, I think we're kind of there. The starters, they start, but every team schedules a cupcake or two, right? I mean, I don't have the Clemson schedule in front of me, but I bet you if you look real hard, there's a cupcake on there. Carolina's got one in Akron, you know, kind of conveniently located in the middle of a tough stretch in September. So those are the games where the backups get a lot more run, get a lot more reps. I don't think we can soften up practice much more than we already have. I mean, we got rid of two-a-days. Yeah. We don't hit nearly as much as we used to. It's a different game already, because it was determined in the spirit of safety that it had to be. So, I mean, look, every one of these guys dreams and believes, in many cases, that they're going to play on Sundays, okay? The NFL is going to go to an 18-game regular season schedule pretty soon. plus two preseason games, plus the postseason, plus mini camp. Do you really think that these guys are not going to be ready to play an extra game or two? I don't buy it. I've heard that for a long, long time.
Hey, but wait a minute. Those NFL guys are getting paid millions of dollars.
Oh, well, yeah.
So are the college guys. I'm sorry. They're getting paid millions.
Exactly.
They're getting paid. Make them play 20 games in college. They're getting paid millions of dollars. Make them play 20 games.
Well, they're not playing 20. They're playing 12, and if they have the fortune to get to the playoff, they could play as many as 15, 16. I don't think that's going to break them. And the guys that, I mean, the programs are going to the playoff are full of NFL guys, okay? I mean, this is not an intramural squad. And the FCS has been doing this for years. Are you saying that the FCS is, they don't care about kids' safety, Phil Kornbluth?
No, but we all know, certainly not, but we all know the reason for FCS playoffs is because they couldn't go to bowl games. No bowl game was taking FCS programs, so they devised the playoff system to give the FCS something to play for. That's why you have FCS playoffs. They had no bowl games to go to.
Well, you gave me the why. I gave you the what. And the what is they play a 16-team playoff at that level.
Yeah.
So they've been playing more games than the so-called big boys for years. So I haven't heard about a rash of injuries at the FCS level come the playoff. So why all of a sudden are we overly concerned about it at the FBS level?
Oh, I'm not overly concerned about it. I say – we're paying them. Let them play. Let them play year round.
I sensed you were reluctant. You were a little cynical there, saying let's just have them all play 20 games. A little sarcastic. So I want you to back off that stance a little bit. Unless you want to die on that hill, you can die on that hill. I don't think that this is a major travesty to see if college athletes want to play in an extra round of playoffs.
I just want to know, you're talking about you used the word we, no longer have two-a-days to go through. When was the last time you went through a two-a-day? At good old Boca Raton High School, huh?
1991, I believe, was the 91-92 was the year. Yes. And let me tell you something. As somebody at about 150 pounds at that point, I did not like the extra contact, Phil Kornbluth.
All right, Mike Morgan, on the move. We appreciate it. Have a great weekend. Can't wait to hear you either on the radio or see you on television doing your thing. And we'll talk to you, hopefully, back in your normal slot next Thursday.
Thanks, Mike.
I hope so. You got it. Take care, guys.
See you, buddy. All right.
Okay.
Mike Morgan, 150 pounds, soaking wet.
How about that?
Back in the day.
Two-a-days in Boca Raton. That must have been fun.
Yeah, I think they play powder puff football at Boca Raton. It's powder
flag
puff.
Football.
Yeah, for sure. Okay, we'll hit the break and come back with, we'll do recruiting. Squeeze in recruiting before the top of the hour. Oh, we're going to give away a basketball at 7:05. Basketball giveaway, 7:05.
Deep in the heart of racing country lies a track too tough to tame. The perfect setting for the late season drama of the Southern 500.
Outside lane gets the launch.
One last chance to make a playoff push. One last chance to catch regular season racing.
All clear.
One last chance to plan a Labor Day weekend worth bragging about.
Southern 500, baby. Hell yeah.
NASCAR weekend at Darlington Raceway, August 31st and September 1st. Get your tickets now at darlingtonraceway.com.
There's a lot of things we take for granted in our lives. Your home's AC will run cool. Your drive-through coffee will be hot. And the car will start when it's time to take your kids to school. It's when things don't go as planned that you start thinking about who to call and where to turn. The good thing is, you can prepare for life's most difficult days by calling the Larry Lucas Agency today. Larry is a State Farm agent that has been taking care of people across South Carolina for more than two decades. You probably have insurance, but switching is easy, and bundling can save you hundreds or more. Most importantly, the Larry Lucas Agency can help you choose the protection you want at the price you want. All backed by South Carolina's number one home and auto insurance company. Visit LarryLucasAgency.com today or give Larry a call at 803-799-1998. Like a good neighbor, Larry Lucas State Farm is there.
Hi, Phil Kornblut here with our good friend George Brian III, heard every Friday night on Birdies, Bogeys, and Biceps right here on Sports Talk. George, the Tsunami Bar, a very valuable tool for golfers. Why is that?
Well, the first thing that I say is the tempo. It's the only tool out there that allows the study of tension right from the first grab to be expressed, and rhythm and tempo is what makes the bar work, and it gives you something awfully special to keep those hands soft and get that rhythm going.
Learn more about Tsunami Bar technology by clicking on the digital ad on our website, sportstalksc.com, and save 5% by purchasing online using the promo code BBB5.
Call Lawyer Lisa. Experience the difference with Lawyer Lisa.
Hi, I'm Lisa Hostetler-Brown. Helping an aging loved one arrange for their care can be one of the most difficult things you will ever do. Fortunately, you don't have to navigate this maze alone. Lawyer Lisa's knowledgeable life care team can lead you down the right path. Visit LawyerLisa.com to see how we can help.
Call Lawyer Lisa. Experience the difference with Lawyer Lisa.
7511 St. Andrews Road, Irmo, South Carolina.
Great things don't happen all at once. Big dreams take time. And when it comes to saving for college, it's those small steps that make a difference. I'm State Treasurer Curtis Loftus. Future Scholar, South Carolina's 529 College Savings Plan, is designed to be taken step by step. You can start with any amount, contributions are tax deductible, and earnings grow tax free. So why wait? Discover the smart, easy way to save for college at FutureScholar.com.
The South Carolina Education Lottery has introduced a new rolling jackpot, and it's big.
How big? Bigger than a striped bass?
Reel them in.
Way bigger.
Bigger than this world-class golf course?
Or
bigger than that.
Even bigger than the Gaffney Peach?
Let's just say with this new rolling jackpot, Palmetto Cash 5 is officially too big to ignore. Palmetto Cash 5 draws nightly, so play today and check if your numbers are winners in the Players Club app or at seeducationlottery.com.
Overall odds are 1 in 10. Top prize odds are 1 in 850,668.
The Sports Talk Recruiting Report is sponsored by Seawells Catering.
Okay, let's get to the recruiting report on this Friday night, brought to you by our good friends at Seawells. All right, well, the soccer, probably too late to grab a parking spot for the soccer since that's all set to go tomorrow, but not too late to get you a parking spot for Gamecock football. Give the folks at Seawells a call. You can grab one of their parking spots, 803-771-7385, or email them at seawellscatering@gmail.com. Of course, the daily lunch and buffet all next week, not on Monday, but Tuesday through Friday. And for the catering business, that's number one all over South Carolina. That is seawellscateringsc.com. 803-771-7385 is the number. South Carolina commitment today, Kendall Daniels, 6'3", 187. He joins a fellow Virginian defensive tackle, Caleb Williams of Chesterfield, in the 25 class. Made his official to USC in June. Also in for the spring game in April. Picked the Gamecocks over Clemson and Virginia Tech. Also had offers from Alabama, Virginia, Texas A&M, Miami, Southern Cal, Texas, Oklahoma, Florida, Auburn, Notre Dame. Plays quarterback in high school. He's a terrific athlete. He plays quarterback and defensive back. Third safety in the class for the Gamecocks, 19th commitment. South Carolina tonight, offensive tackle Juan Gaston of Atlanta is to announce. USC, Tennessee, Georgia, Oregon. Recruiting networks have been pointing towards Georgia, most likely for him. Clemson still waiting. Ole Miss still waiting for Dylan Alford to go public with an announcement. The wide receiver from Saraland, Alabama, had said he would do it today. Hasn't happened yet. Tomorrow for South Carolina, Gamecocks have some more suspense. Defensive end Jared Smith of Alabaster, Alabama. It's Carolina, Auburn, Georgia, and Ole Miss. The network projections are all for Auburn. And then offensive guard Jalen Gilchrist of Virginia Beach, USC, Maryland, and Georgia. The networks are projecting him to South Carolina. Okay, there you go. Recruiting on Sports Talk.
Welcome back to Sports Talk on the Sports Talk Media Network. You can reach the guys with the South Carolina Education Lottery lucky number, 888-898-2525. That's 888-898-2525. Now back to Phil and Chris with a second hour of Sports Talk on the Sports Talk Media Network.
Okay, we've got to move quickly. Got to move quickly here because we want to get to Marcus Tate. We want to get to our interview with Mr. Ashford, Robbie Ashford from South Carolina. So I promised a giveaway tonight of a USC Women's Championship basketball honoring the Gamecocks women's basketball team that won another national championship this past season. Beautiful, beautiful basketball. They did a great job with it. We've given one away. We're going to give a second one away right now. Phone number 888-898-2525. 888-898-2525. We want to move quickly. So give an answer and get off the phone. Unless you get the answer right, and then you need to hold on to the phone so we can get your information. So our question tonight, our trivia question for South Carolina women's basketball to win the commemorative basketball, recognizing South Carolina's championship of last season. Who was the first All-American in USC women's basketball history? The first All-American in USC women's basketball history. Okay, if you know the answer or think you know the answer, we ask that you don't Google it or go to the World Book Encyclopedia or ask your granddad or grandma. Dig deep into the bowels of your brain and see if you can do it yourself, Chris. What do you think?
Do you know what an encyclopedia is?
Who, me?
No, I know you do. I asked Josh.
Yes, I know what an encyclopedia is. Okay. Thank you. I appreciate your concern.
I was concerned we may have aged ourselves too far.
The World Book, everybody
had Wikipedia, encyclopedia.
Yeah. Everybody, when we grew up, had a World Book Encyclopedia. If you didn't have that, you were uneducated. All right, Josh, are you ready to go to the phone, sir?
We are. We're going to Ralph.
All right, let's just run through them. We don't need names unless you win. Keep your name to yourself. Well, we might need a name to identify. I don't know. We're just kind of flying by the seat of our pants.
Okay.
Ralph, what you got?
Well, first, it's cash only parking tomorrow at Sea Wells. Cal is too busy getting reservations for football.
Okay.
But Dr. Parker, I'm trying to remember her first name.
Martha. Martha Parker. Yeah, she was an All-American, but she was not the first.
Okay.
Appreciate it. Appreciate it. We got to run. Appreciate. Try again. If the lines open up, try again. We want to get to a winner here as soon as we can. We go next to, just taking the call. Caller, welcome in. What's your name and what's your guess? And turn your radio down. They're not going to know we're talking to them. How are they going to know we're talking to them? Yeah, it's you. Go ahead. Hello.
Katrina Anderson?
Are you Katrina?
No, I'm guessing. That's my guess.
That is not a guess. That is the correct answer.
Really?
Yes, it is.
Ah, great.
That is fantastic. Did you know this? Or, I mean, did you have some, obviously you had some idea, but I mean,
Yeah. Well, we're big women's basketball fans. And we've had tickets for a long time, but I don't know. This was way back before my time.
1979. She was an All-American in 1979. Played 2 years at South Carolina and was outstanding. Scorer and rebounder and made All-American. So, well, we thank you for that. What's your first name?
Ashley.
And where are you calling from?
Rock Hill.
Very good. Well, if you will hold on, Josh will get your name and your mailing address, cell number, and you'll have this basketball by next week.
Oh, my goodness. Thank you. You have just made my day. Thank you so much.
You'll love it. It's a beautiful piece of commemorative material to look back on the season. Thank you very much for coming through in the clutch. Ralph, you got outgunned by a – you know what? This warms my heart, Chris, because we've done this contest twice, and women have come out of the woodwork.
What we wanted, exactly. And we didn't have to exclude the men.
That's right. I thought about excluding the men. I said, no, we'll open it up. But congratulate. We've had two women to win this thing, but I mean, appreciate all the women who listen to Sports Talk with their husbands or their children or whoever the case may be, their boyfriends. And glad to have you on board, and congratulations, Ashley, on that correct answer, Katrina Anderson of 1979. Okay.
I have to ask, and I don't remember, I do know Sheila Foster. I know the name and didn't really get to see her play. I was looking at some history to learn more about Katrina Anderson. Sheila Foster was only a second-team All-America choice in 82. Are you kidding me?
If you say so.
As good as she was, school's all-time leading scorer. I guess that she's still all-time leading scorer, correct?
Or did no, Asia I think Wilson she was pass passed by Asia Wilson, yeah. I think, yeah. But she was
nonetheless,
great back in
amazing.
Her day.
Yeah, amazing player.
Great
amazing
back
player.
In her day. All right, want to get to the football interviews because we want to continue our coverage of the camps. South Carolina Clemson will be commencing our Palmetto Pigskin Tour next week, hitting up other schools around the state. But right now, Robbie Ashford, South Carolina quarterback candidate, transfer from Auburn, had a chance to talk with him yesterday at South Carolina Media Day. Here's that conversation.
Well, Robbie, first of all, as you get ready for the start of camp, what is your mindset going in, the competition at quarterback amongst all you guys? Because I know Coach Beamer always talks about competing and not settling on anybody at this particular point.
Yeah, you know, just for me, you know, I've been in college football for a minute. So, you know, just coming out with that mindset of just knowing camp's a grind. It's a mental test, and it's really meant to test your mental, and that's what makes you better on as things go on. But, you know, just coming in and staying level-headed, not getting too high, not getting too low, because I'm definitely my own worst critic. So, you know, just staying in those moments where things aren't going good, I still got to be up because I got 10 other guys looking at me. So, you know, just coming in and there and then, you know, just competing. I mean, as a competitor, you always want competition. So I never want anything handed to me, and that's why I came here. So, you know, just going out to compete with these guys in this room, I mean, they've been great. And, you know, we're just here to push each other. You know, only one guy can play quarterback at a time, but we know whoever it is going to be the best man for the job. And it's all love in this room, so it's no hatred. And I've been in rooms where it's been like that, but since I've been here, it's been nothing but love. So I appreciate these guys and just excited to get out to go and work with just this whole team.
When you looked at South Carolina as you were evaluating what you were going to do next, coming from an SEC school, and you talked to Coach Beamer and Coach Loggins and checked out the roster and everything else about the program, what was most appealing to you that led you here?
You know, just what Coach Loggins has just done with quarterbacks and just what he's done over the years. I mean, just looking at Spence, I mean, you see those things. And I definitely knew things I needed to improve on. And, you know, in college, I just haven't had a coach who just can work with me just on the fundamentals, just – throwing just anything I need to know, like they have him and Coach Shula. I mean, man, I've learned so much, and I've learned in the past 4 years of college ball and 6 months. I mean, those guys have been great, and you know, just Coach Beamer, just what he stands for, and just seeing all that. And then when I came here, I was just blown away, and felt like this is where I needed to be. So,
you and Coach Shula, do y'all exchange a little Alabama Auburn rivalry tit for tat?
Oh yeah, all the time. You know. You like I might say something wrong or, you know, just anything I might do wrong, but like, oh, that's that Auburn education right there. But, you know, I know it's all out of love, so I can't do anything but laugh. I'm like, man, nah, that ain't it. But, yeah, I mean, he loves to joke with me about it, but, you know, that's what makes it fun. I mean, that's just what keeps things entertaining when you got things to talk about. So it's good to be able to have those type of relationships too.
So with you, everybody knows you as a terrific athlete, really good runner, questionable passer. What do you have to do to make yourself that complete quarterback?
You know, first it starts with being healthy. I mean, you know, a lot of people like to say I'm a questionable passer, but a lot of people don't know I was when in the year I was starting, I was getting four shots a game just to be able to play in my throwing shoulder. So I feel like we should really – let's talk about me as a passer when I'm healthy. If you go look at before what I was doing, it was nothing like when you're sitting there getting four shots a game, you know. So, I mean, it's just really just – proving those people wrong, because I know I wouldn't have got brought here if I couldn't throw the ball. I mean, I wouldn't have started in the SEC if I couldn't throw the ball. And, you know, a lot of people, they don't know what goes into it. They don't know. It's just not on me. It's 11 guys doing their job collectively. And, you know, sometimes things break down. And, I mean, that's just football. But, you know, a lot of people, you know, they think they know what they're talking about and all that. And you just got to let them do it, because they don't know the real. Like, nobody knew what I was going through at Auburn, because, you know, you don't sell those type of things. But now, since it's done, like, yeah, I can tell the whole world, yeah. When y'all were saying I couldn't throw whoop-de-whoop, y'all didn't even know I couldn't practice. Like, I couldn't even lift my arm up, and I was going out there getting four shots a game. So, you know, just being healthy is the main thing. I mean, no quarterback wants to sit there and go through that, definitely in their throwing shoulder. So, you know, you just got to let those people talk and say what they want to. They can never get out here and do what I do in the first place. So I look at it like that. Like, yeah, you can sit from your couch, talk. When you want to come out here and show me you can do what I can do, let me know. And please come out here and show me you can do it better than me before you start talking. But, you know, it's nothing crazy, man. You know, it's something you grow up with, just hearing things. And, I mean, just definitely as a black quarterback, you know, you hate us like this, but we get that stigmatism around us that we're just athletes and we can run. And as always, we can play another position. It's never just firm on we're just a quarterback. It's always got to be we're an athlete. So, you know, those type of things, it's like you want to go out there and prove those people wrong just because you know you can do it. You know, you got a group of guys around you who believe in you and a coaching staff that believes in you. And that's all you need. All the other outside people, their opinions could matter less to us. To me, this team, we don't care about the outside noise. So,
shoulder good now?
Yes, sir. Shoulder feeling good. So, no, I'm excited to get out there and just sling the rock around with these guys. I mean, it's an exciting group. So, I'm excited. I'm really excited.
All right, last thing, how hot is this competition going to be with you and Lenoris and Dante and Davis and anybody else they have in there? I mean, what?
It's going to be a good comp. I mean, it's just going to be great work day in, day out. And, you know, you just look at it, may the best man win. I mean, we're going to do it with love and a smile on our face. And we know whoever's the starter, we're going to back them 100%. And, I mean, it's football. I mean, you're one play away from being in the game. So whoever's the starter, you always wish them the best. You never want any injuries. But whoever's a backup, you got to be ready to go at any second, because just in the snap of a finger, you're in the game. And what are you going to do? So just staying ready and just staying focused. And just staying prepared. I mean, that's the biggest thing, preparation. I feel like everybody in this room prepares really good. We got a smart room, just guys who love ball. So when you add all that together, it makes up for a great competition, just a great quarterback room to get as a whole.
There you go. Comments of Robbie Ashford competing for the quarterback job at South Carolina. Like the way he talks. And
yeah,
keep an eye on that. Keep an eye on that competition, I'd say.
I hate that he still believes, and I think obviously it's still true, about the stigmatism of the black quarterback just being an athlete, not a thrower. And it's unfortunate because it's just not true anymore.
No.
You look at three of the top four passers in the NFL last year were all three quarterbacks of color. And the game has changed. I just wish maybe our perception of the game and the way it's played would keep up.
Could not agree more. Clemson has just gotten a commitment for the 26th class in football. Give you that after the break.
Oh, appliances. We can't live without them, and eventually we have to replace them, but we don't have to pay more for the new ones. Not with Carolina Discount Appliances. Do you want to go and shop at a bunch of retail stores and determine which one has the lowest overpriced item? Me neither. That's why my first call is always Carolina Discount Appliances. The philosophy is simple. No retail prices. None. It might have a scratch or a ding, but overall, it's new and will cost you much less than what you're going to pay anywhere else. So if you need a refrigerator, washer, dryer, dryer, stove, range, or microwave, they've got you covered. But for less money, same brands, same appliances, less money. And Carolina Discount Appliances is the home of the $40 down. Take it home today. No credit needed, payment options. Regardless, Sherry has you covered. Call today, 803-770-3008. That's 770-3008. No matter where you're located, same number, same person, Sherry at Carolina Discount Appliances, 803-770-3008. It saved me money. It'll do the same for you.
We're with Major Billy Downer of the Department of Natural Resources. Major Downer, let's say I'm out in the woods or I'm on the water and I need to reach a DNR agent. How do I do that?
Operation Game Thief, Phil. It's been around 30-plus years. You can call us at our 24-hour hotline any time of day, 1-800-922-5431. To report wildlife violations or to get help if you're in trouble in the woods or on the water, call us at Operation Game Thief, 1-800-922-5431.
Relax this summer with a promotional rate on select travel purchases with your Founders Federal Credit Union credit card. Now through August 31st, get 6.99% APR for 6 months on qualifying purchases, including airfare, hotels, restaurants, and cruise lines. Don't let interest rates slow you down this summer. Visit foundersfcu.com/travel to learn more. Not a Founders member yet? Founders has the financial tools you need and the personalized service you deserve. Stop by an office or visit foundersfcu.com to learn more about Founders and see if you qualify for membership. On March 1st, 2025, the promotional APR will revert to the effective APR as previously disclosed. Call 800-845-1644 for details about credit costs and terms. Membership qualification required.
I'm attorney Jim Corbett. I'm not a case manager. I'm a lawyer for over 35 years. I don't charge 40% for your injury in your wreck case or any on-the-job injury. Call 803-765-2968 and ask for Jim Corbett or email me, jim@jimcorbettattorney.com, for the experience of a lawyer handling your injury case. Jim Corbett, 803-765-2968, jim@jimcorbettattorney.com. Put 35 years of experience to work on your injury case.
If you're looking to stay hydrated this summer, turn toward a southern favorite, sweet South Carolina watermelons. One slice is equivalent to a glass of water and is just as effective as sports drinks for hydration. If you don't believe us, you can ask the Palmetto State's top football teams. The SC Watermelon Association will be serving up slices after summer practice to keep our teams fueled and hydrated. Visit scwatermelon.org for all the details and look for ripe South Carolina watermelons in your hometown.
You've put in the work for your education. The extra early, extra late, extra, extra work. That's because you understand education opens doors to better pay, better opportunities, and a better you. Being educated about playing the lottery is no different. It helps you be a better player, one who knows when to play and when to take a rain check. The lottery's a game, so let's keep it fun. Learn more at sceducationlottery.com/betteryou.
All right, just a few moments ago, 2026 cornerback Shavar Young from Knoxville announced a commitment to Clemson. So he chooses the Tigers. He was there for a visit just the other day, according to Paul Strelo from Tiger Illustrated, and pretty heavily recruited, had a lot of big-time offers. He's definitely a corn cob.
He's a corn cob?
Corn cob awesome. Level, yeah. Not the corn stalk, but the corn cob level prospect. Yeah, heavily recruited. So he commits to Clemson. Also a big-time receiver, had impressive numbers as a receiver, but the Tigers like him as a cornerback. So Clemson picks up a 2026 commitment from cornerback Shavar Young out of Knoxville, Tennessee. Now, Chris,
what league
to the,
he'll be playing in when he comes to Clemson?
I beg your pardon?
I wonder what league he'll be playing in when he comes to Clemson in 2026.
I suspect the ACC still. Yeah. I suspect the ACC for Clemson. More on that later. Let's get to what you've got today from the Clemson camp with one of the Tiger players.
Yeah, some good stuff from the Tigers. You don't normally get to hear all the offensive linemen come through, especially on the first day of camp. But you know what college coaches tell us, Phil? It all starts up front. Well, Clemson buying into that as they sent all their offensive linemen through the meat grinder last night after the first day of practice. We picked up on Marcus Tate, who I thought was outstanding. He had some really good stuff to say about how they've developed, how hungry they are. And he started off answering a question about his good buddy Walker Parks and his ability to help him out on the offensive line.
I guess just if we just talk to Walker, well, what did you observe in terms of his process, you know, coming back from the ankle injury? He's talking about you guys coming and bringing him food and stuff like that. What was that like?
I would just say the process for him, like, I don't know, like, how he stayed mentally, you know, strong through it, because, you know, when you what happened to him, you know, you can really go sideways. I know that dealing with injury myself, just, you know, constantly trying to be out there when you can't, you know, and wanting to be out there. But, I mean, he did everything he could to get back. And I think all of us as the O-line just wanted to make sure that we could be there the best way we could for him. And I mean, the effort that he put into getting back, you know, it made it easy for us to, you know, want to give that same energy to him because he was already leading himself that way. And I'm just very ecstatic to see him back because he worked really hard to get here. I know he wants to be on the field with us. And, you know, I've known Walker for 4 years now, and he's one of my best friends. And just to be able to play with him on the field again is such an amazing blessing. I'm happy he's back on the field with us.
Talking to Blake and Tristan outside, they talked about just the continuity that this offensive line has moving from last year to now. Just what are the conversations you guys had? What are your personal expectations for what this starting five can achieve?
Yeah, so from a continuity standpoint, I just feel like, you know, we were very intentional with hanging out with each other, you know, from spring to now. You know, me and Tristan are roommates. You know, we're always hanging out with Blake and them. Like, we made that a focal point for this offseason just because, you know, it's very important that we're very close and, you know, we know how each other move and our little intricacies. And I think that will show this year more than ever. You know, I got a year under playing next to Tristan now. So, you know, I have a good idea of what he does on each play, and he has a good idea of what I do. And I feel like that experience together is really going to take us to the next step. And, you know, Walker and Blake, they played next to each other in 2022 and some parts of last year. So I really feel like that's going to show we're much older, especially with Coach Luke coming in and, you know, providing the experience that he has and giving us the knowledge that he has. I think it's really going to take us to the next level.
You take losses hard that you care. Where does that come from? And is that true? Does it? You're like the ultimate competitor.
Yeah. So I would say for me, it started as when I was young, just living in a household with my older sister. She's a sore loser, and I kind of get it from there. Like we always were competing back in the day, and she hated to lose. And I kind of picked it up for her. I've never been a big fan of losing. I try to put my all into everything that I do. And, you know, that's our motto here is all in, you know what I'm saying? And when you put your all into something and you don't get the result that you want, you know, it hits you hard. And I just, you know, I've always been a tough person when it comes to losing. But I've been better. I'm trying to get better with it, keeping my head high. Because especially now that I'm a senior, you know, I got to be able to lead our team when, you know, we're in low moments. And that's what I really want to grow this year into, being a leader. And when, you know, we are down, that I'm able to keep us up and, you know, not getting too emotional because, you know, we're losing or something like that.
Marcus, can you describe the flexibility that you guys have with you and Walker and Colin available at guard and just all the different sort of?
Well, yeah, I think the flexibility is huge for us, especially since we're playing more games this year. And, you know, Colin being able to fill whatever spot on the O-line, you know, him being able to play left tackle, left guard, right tackle is huge for us. You know, with me and Walker, you know, we're guys that have been, you know, injured before, and we played a lot of snaps and stuff like that. I think it would be huge that he can come in and fill those spots. And even for me, I could, you know, kind of play left tackle when I need to. Walker can play right tackle when he needs to. Like, us just having that ability to do that is going to be huge for our line. I think it's going to push a lot of the other guys in the room to, you know, step up their game. And I think that it's already shown, you know what I'm saying? And I think that's just a testament to the training that we put in the offseason, especially with, you know, Colin and Walker really just, you know, not just being a robot in one position, learning every position they can. Like, Colin could play literally all positions. So, you know, it's really a testament to his offseason work.
All right, comments of Marcus Tate, Clemson offensive guard. And as we said earlier, Chris, this offensive line of Clemson, if they play well, they've got a chance to be a good cohesive unit, considering four of the guys returning were all starters at one time.
I think so, and I think that can only help, obviously, the run game, but also Cade Klubnik because there were times when he made his mistakes is when he got a lot of pressure in his face or coming off the edge. And if these guys are as cohesive as they seem to be coming out of the off season, they should be in great shape. And Marcus Tate's just a good dude. I mean, here's a guy, young man that's helped mentor incarcerated youth down in South Florida. He's also helping underprivileged kids, elementary school kids up in the upstate. He's a guy you could probably see as a poli-sci major, maybe running for public office once his playing days are done.
Yeah. Like the mayor of Clemson, Eric McClain.
Exactly.
That kid, when he came to Clemson as a freshman, he was as polished as I've ever seen. He was ready for politics from day one. Not that he's going to go into politics. You know, he's doing pretty well in the ACC network right now. Speaks well.
And
he
Marcus
was always
Tate. Yeah.
He was always kind of a lead spokesman for the Clemson offense.
Yeah, Marcus Tate may fall into that category if things don't work well for him at the NFL. Maybe TV's in his future as well.
Okay. Let's talk some golf. Stay tuned. George Brian coming up. Birdies, bogeys, biceps.
Four. Straight down the middle. It went straight down the middle. Then it started to hook just a wee bit. And that's when my caddy lost sight of it. That little white pellet has never been found to this day. But it went straight down the middle, like they say.
Well, if you're able to dodge the storms out there, get in some golf, cart path only, the three... There's two pairs of the three worst words in golf. As George Brian III joins us, birdies, bogeys, and biceps. Those aren't the three worst words in golf. There's a pair of them. There's a set of the three worst words in golf. You're still up and cart path only. I don't like hearing either one of those, George, when I'm on the golf course. I think I really dislike cart path only because, you know, walking is not part of my forte when it comes to golf.
Well, you're still away. that's one of those. And at the end of a rough hole, what did you have on that hole? That one's on.
That's more than three words, but that one hurts too. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. It's. Anyhow, but what a beautiful time of the year, and enjoyed it last week, mixing it up with you a little bit on that golf course.
Yep.
Look forward to another swing at things, and man, this week is a most unique week for golf, and one that, I don't know, to me, doesn't get a lot of press, a lot of play, but I think we're going to tee it up on this day to talk quite a bit about it, right?
I think we are. We got two big events going on. Let's begin with the 93rd South Carolina Golf Association Amateur Championship. Everybody's in now. I did a leaderboard update at the start of the show. This is at the Country Club of Charleston, so they're two rounds in, George. And how about Zach Adams of Charleston, a pair of 64s, at that golf course. So he is 14 under par. He's got the lead by three shots over the youngster Chase Klein of Chapin, who went 66-65. And then there's the venerable Todd White, 70 and 63. Georgie shoots a 63 today at the Country Club of Charleston. So he's at 9 under, tied with Matthew Doyle of Somerville, who went 67-66. And then we have two golfers at 6 under, Lucas Acevedo from Daniel Island, a 70 and a 66. And I'm sorry, he stands alone. He stands alone in fifth place. So that's your top five, Zach Adams, Chase Klein, Todd White, Matthew Doyle, and Lucas Acevedo. What about those guys? What do you know? I know you know all about Todd White.
Well, I watched him. I got a few miles ahead of him, so I watched him come along in college golf. Now, he's been easy to follow in amateur golf, and he's probably the best player in the country in his age division, and he's proven he might be one of the best players in all divisions. So it's really
special. I had a conversation about coaching golf with one of his players that he coaches. He's a great high school golf coach, in addition to being a great player. And the way I look at coaches as far as greatness is their style and what little – I've never spoken to Todd about his coaching philosophy, but what little I learned yesterday tells me he's already a great high school golf coach through one of his students. Not going to mention names, didn't get permission to do that.
Mm.
But from what I picked up from one of his team, one of his team members, absolutely beautiful. He believes, at least what I know through his player, a lot of what I think is best about golf. You go out and figure it out. Todd White did figure it out. He did a great job in college golf. Didn't quite achieve that PGA Tour dream being a regular on the tour. He does. He's got golf. He's got professional in his golf past. But he shined and reached, looks like he's peeking out at the right time in the world of senior golf, and he's quite dominant. But he's also taking a swing and doing a pretty good job in amateur golf against the young bucks. I've watched Chase Klein, watched him grow up, watched him grow into golf. An amazing fan. Still know Chase's dad and granddad, and he comes from great stock. In fact, Chase's uncle is a doc. Speaking of good stock, he's a great doc. He's got an uncle that's a great doc, and I was playing golf with one of his friends today talking about Chase Klein's not just current greatness, but what I think he could be another one that we talk a lot about over the years. This young fella is fearless. He said in the Western Carolina, and most people don't realize it, but he's not just going as a one-sport athlete. He's going as a two-sport athlete. Did you know that, Phil Kornbluth?
I did. I believe he's a pretty good baseball player, isn't he?
Close. It does involve a ball. But
he's a pretty good basketball player, isn't he?
I think he's a good basketball and a baseball player. He's a great athlete, but he's going to be playing football.
He's going to go as a football player, isn't he?
Oh, he is.
I knew I'd get to the right one at some point.
Hey, it was a lot of fun. I'm playing with a longtime friend. He's actually very special to me. I did not get permission to use his name. He knows who he is, though.
Mm-hmm.
I played with a couple of my heroes today. These men were very influential, and I watched them save my mama's life. So they're doctors, and even though they wouldn't mind. The conversation did lock down on not just Olympic golf, but Chase Klein in state amateur golf, and that should be a wonderful show. I don't know what the admission standards would be, so I can't speak at this point, but golly, you ought to at least take a swing at getting in Country Club of Charleston to go watch two great players, Zach Adams and Chase Klein, will put on an amazing show tomorrow. And there are others, Todd White. I think my guess would be they're playing threesomes. And what a unbelievable. I wish I could get there to watch it. Country Club of Charleston, if you don't have a chance to play, it probably is, well, it's one of my favorite golf courses in the world. And old, but absolute wonderful. And those guys are going to put on a show.
All right,
but
so
Zach Adams, he's a gangster.
Now let me ask you about Zach.
He will be hard to keep up with.
Yeah, let me ask you about Zach, and let's talk about his round today. I mean, 64, that's 32 on top of 32. And he put a 64 on top of a 64. As I said earlier, I've done that before, George, except my 64 was on the front nine, then my other 64 was on the back nine. Nobody's laughing at it. I thought that was a hell of a funny golf joke.
I think it's wonderful.
Nobody's getting it. Okay, anyway, he opened up with a bogey on one, and then he went par-par, and then a couple of birdies, a par. He finished, made the turn with three straight birdies, and then he came out on the second nine with a par and a bogey, and then four birdies coming home, 32-32. That's good playing, 64. And on that golf course, of course, we had a 63 out there today, too, by Todd White. Are those scores about what you thought you would see at the Country Club of Charleston for this event?
I did not know how they set it up, didn't know where the rough was, so I had no way to forecast. But those scores are amazing. And what I'll just say is if the tournament committee would like, they probably can find flag placement to protect or insulate low scores. But my hope is they let them go. Just keep going. And I don't think they can do anything much with the grass. Would not be able to comment on whether they're playing in much rough. But these guys, especially the young ones, they have no fear. And the ones we're talking about with Chase Klein and Zach Adams, I had a chance to speak with Zach Adams last week. Not in depth, but he came. We crossed paths, and he was with the new coach we've had on our show, Coach Bradley. And I got the feeling just with a brief exchange that Zach's game's in really good shape. And those two fellas right there are going to be really hard to keep up with based on what has happened the first two rounds. They have no fear. And they are shooting low is not something they get nervous about. In fact, it excites them. And the way these guys think, if they shot 63 today, and that's what be interesting to have Todd White. We've bounced that around, and hopefully we can get him on the show because I would love to find out more about his current perspective, the one in senior golf. But my guess is if Todd White shot 63 today, he thinks he can do it tomorrow and even better. And that's the way Zach and Chase watched them both grow up. I can assure you that's more how they're thinking than, oh, my gosh, I want to hold on to something. They're not going to hold on to anything except that target where they want that ball to go. They'll hold on to that. And everybody else in that field, they better be ready to go even lower. That's what I'm thinking. That's what I'm predicting.
So, in your mind, it's George Bryan here, Birdies, Bogeys, and Biceps on Sports Talk. This is the 93rd edition of the SCGA South Carolina State Amateur Championship. How prestigious is this event in the state of South Carolina and maybe in the region? I mean, when you look at the tournament, the history, 93 years, the courses that it's been played on over the years, to win this event, what does it mean to the golfer who wins it?
Well, one of the things that anybody who competes in a golf championship such as this will not just look at the history, look at the venues, look at courses, look at the names on the trophy. And if those names on the trophy don't excite you a little bit, we're talking numerous PGA Tour winners, numerous champions. These kind of things, the South Carolina Golf Association for a lot of years has produced some of the greatest players in the world. So in my mind, it always was and still is one of the most prestigious events any of the amateurs can play in.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I know a few times I've even had this conversation with my children back when they were in college. They'd go play in supposedly an amateur event that was more prestigious, and they did. They did take a step away, but you can look on that trophy. Neither one of my children have their name on it, and I think they should have played more. Maybe they would have a chance, but they're not going to do it now. But they did try other avenues, but both of them came back and tried to win that event before they got into pro golf. And it's not a USGA event. It doesn't have those initials, but it's the next best thing. And you take a look at Country Club of Charleston and the history there, one of the first great names that I think about is Beth Daniels. So she's absolutely one of the greatest names in all of golf, and that's her home golf course.
Yeah.
They have a tournament named after her. So that's what the players, in my opinion, they play for the game of golf and the event, the trophy. So when those guys – hey, did you watch
did you watch Xander at the British Open breeze by the trophy in the final round? I can't remember the gaze, but you watch any of the players, that trophy's sitting right there on the tee box. And I can tell you, that's a daunting monument sitting there. It's like, yeah, I want that thing. I want it so bad I can taste it. And that usually is one of the first problems they have to encounter themselves. And that's the truth.
Well, now, let me ask you this about the amateur championship here in South Carolina. The Country Club of Charleston, obviously a great choice. History, beauty, layout, competitiveness. What are four or five? Well, that's maybe too many. Give me three or four other courses in South Carolina that are worthy of hosting this championship, where you'd like to see the championship played. Maybe it's already been played at these courses, but places you'd like to see the championship played on a kind of a semi-regular basis.
You know, that's they've got a great SCJGA. If you just take a look at where they've been in the past, right down there in Charleston, Daniel Island has hosted the event. Wild Dunes hosted a state amateur that I competed in, Frank Ford. I mentioned the name, Beth Daniels, the Ford family. That is a Hall of Fame golf family. But right in Charleston, there's another great golf course not too far from there by water. It's called the Ocean Course. That's not
Wait,
too bad a track.
Do you want to play the amateur championship on the Ocean Course?
Oh, I'm just throwing it out. You have great golf courses.
Yeah.
The Golf Association, the SCGA, has always done a spectacular job at identifying great golf courses, courses that will keep up, will hold on to its integrity through all the improvements in technology and the improved skill, but other great golf courses on the rotation. The Palmetto, that's a great golf course in South Carolina. Yeamans Hall is another great golf course in Charleston. If you go around South Carolina, Florence Country Club, Jimmy Hawkins won that state amateur years ago. I remember vividly him coming down the stretch and just unbelievable play. There's a course that stood the test of time. Over Myrtle Beach, a number of courses. You know, I don't want to leave. I think Tidewater is a great golf course. Not sure that's been on their state amateur on the state amateur rotation, but Greenville Country Club, Chanticleer, great golf course, and has been on the Musgrove Mill, another great golf course, withstanding the test of equipment, the improvements in equipment. We've got in South Carolina, we've got some of the best golf courses in the whole world right here. Just spoke to the PGA. The soon-to-be PGA of America president. Guess where the president, future president of the PGA, is going to live starting this fall? One guess. Where's your favorite?
I would say Kiowa.
Where's your favorite place? No. Your favorite place where you frequent, where you actually, you told me you love to go there frequently.
On
the coast.
Myrtle Beach?
Exactly right.
Mm-hmm.
John Ray will be moving. The PGA, the future PGA president, will be a resident at Myrtle Beach within months. So South Carolina just draws them all. We have I'm going to leave a number of them off. You know, there's Camden Country Club right outside the Midlands. Doesn't get much notoriety, but just a great old Donald Ross golf course. Hey, Quixote, I heard that name. I got a...
Yeah.
Invited to play by Billy Dillon in a pro event at Quixote, and what an amazing! I haven't been there, but it was Sunset Country Club was already had good track, good foundation. Now hadn't played Quixote, but I look forward to being there. There's another one just read about on the horizon, Broomstay. We have Tree Farm, new clubs in this area. Tree Farm, Old Barnwell. There's a new one called 21 Club, supposedly, that's going to be off the charts. But state amateur clubs right here in Columbia Country Club has hosted numerous state amateurs, and what a great course that is right here in the Midlands. So
anyway, you can tell I love South Carolina golf, and South Carolina Golf Association does an amazing job, and that's a premier championship in my mind in the country.
All right, let's go quickly to the Men's Olympic Golf Competition, is how they list it, at the Le Golf National in Paris. A little bit of French there from the corn. So Xander Schauffele is 11 under with Hideki Matsuyama. They're both 11 under. Matsuyama with a 63 today. Schauffele with a 66. Here's Tommy Fleetwood. Oh, he's also tied for the lead. Tommy Fleetwood's 11 under after a 64, so a three-way tie. Then John Rahm at 9. Thomas Dietrich at 8. C.T. Pan at 8. Tom Kim at 8. Steven Yeager at 7. Guido Migliozzi at 7 under. Eric Van Ruin at 6 under. Joaquin Niemann at 6 under. Scotty Scheffler is 6 under. And let's see, pick out a couple of others of note. Rory McIlroy is 5 under. Colin Morikawa is 4 under. So, I mean, this has got all the looks and all the smells and all the flavor of a major with this leaderboard.
Absolutely beautiful. And I'm not sure. We watched a little bit what I'd say. It was recorded. We had fun at the mountains. I visited Old Edwards and Glen Cove, the saddle, this past week, Bill. And we were watching recorded on Thursday evening. First and second round. We'll watch that again recorded tonight. But I was curious, are they going to preview the early morning because they're ahead of schedule? Are they going to be showing the telecast live early in the morning as they did the British Open? Or do you know? You're looking it up.
I know their airtime is 3 a.m. So
there we go. Yes, sir.
Yeah.
And that kind of thing excites me. And I will tell you, I was speaking with, Dr. Sean again. I went out and played Selena Golf Club today with Dr. Sean, Dr. Chris. Those are two of my heroes. They actually, the way you get hero in my world, you saved my mama's life a couple of times, and they did. They're specialists. Those guys, my first time ever getting a chance to play with these two men. They did wonderful job. My mom now is in heaven. They tacked on years with medicine and their care. But I was so nervous playing golf with them. You have no idea. I was just excited to play golf with men. And we got on the topic of what these men and women would be going through when they're playing for their country. And golf is a little different, man. It's way different. While you are trying to be rhythmic and smooth, and your heart rate's going through the roof. We're talking about 150, 100, 140, 50, 60 elevated heart rates, and you're trying to do something patiently. It reminds me a little bit of maybe the marksmanship, watching these folks that are having to be very precise, very still, but that heart rate is absolutely through the roof. And that's why I think Scotty Scheffler, he's at 6 under. He's still right in the middle of it. Xander has got the advantage. He's got the hot hand. I'd be hard-pressed to think anybody could win this event but him, and he wants to play for his country.
Yeah.
That's a fact.
Just don't drink the water out of the river if you get thirsty.
You know, I heard you're going to need a little help. There's some stuff going on, but hopefully they got that cleaned up. And they can get back to, I think the truck. Are the other events that involve the aquatics back on schedule yet?
That I do not know. Chris, have you watched that? I don't know.
I mean, the swimming events have all been fine in the indoor pool. It's the triathlon where they tried to swim in the dirty sin.
Yeah.
What's the problem?
Yep, I'd heard that was on delay, and preferably they'll put that back on the schedule, and they do get the water cleaned up. Stuff happens. So, but I tell you what, the conversation. Hey, the conversation.
Stuff does happen. You're right, George.
Yeah, that's one of those things we don't have any control over, so you deal with it. And But it is exciting to watch golfers play for the country. This is new to golf, and I think it brings another variable that appreciate the chance to get to talk about. It's something that Ryder Cup players, President Cup players have the Curtis Cup players, Walker Cup, they have that chance, but there's just not as much, in my opinion, that needs to be playing for town, country, and town, state, and country. I think that would add quite an interesting element to the game, and my hope would be, with that music, that we get more inter-club competitions going. So, hey, like always, man, that's a lot of fun tonight. Sponsored by Tsunami Bar Sports. There's a lot to talk about in the near future with the technology. Until then, until next week, TMI, but shoot them low, man.
Thank you, George. Juan Gaston to Georgia. Dylan Alfred to Ole Miss. Chris, have a great weekend.
You too, guys. See you Monday.
Thank you, Josh. See you Monday.